Thanks a lot. Welcome to my talk, Project Ironman, Large-Scale CSS Refactoring. This talk is a story about legacy CSS and how to refactor it. I'm Christoph, and as already said in the introduction, I'm working at Trivago since 2012. Maybe a fun fact behind that is that I was the first front-end developer they hired. And the existing front-end of the product was mainly written by full-stack and back-end devs, and this became quite the story of my life. Coming to Project Ironman, here's the business translation for refactor all the things. This is even the buzzword free definition. In short, we created the first version of a design system and with it a CSS framework, which we needed to integrate into our core product, the Trivago Hotel Search. I would like to give you some bigger context about this project first. We didn't do that because it's a lot of fun, but due to real business reasons. One of them was to establish consistency in code and design in our products and therefore integrate the new system we have created. And with it, improve code quality and maintainability, or more in general, to reduce technical debt. And with this, we wanted, of course, to provide a new base for a fast and but sustainable UI rebuild of our core product. But before tackling the most business critical application which we have at Trivago, we did a case study beforehand. Approximately a year ago, we introduced a pattern library and started to use atomic design in our design development workflow. This was our company pages before we relaunched them. It was a horrible mixture of Bootstrap 1, 2, 3, and whatever. It was basically developed with copy and paste development. We relaunched it upon the design system we had created and started also to create, relaunch some other side applications. Coming back to our core product, the Trivago Hotel Search. As already said, the UI was mainly created by backend developers, and when I joined the team, they came to me and said, hey, we are using SAS now, and you will be happy when you see our front-end code. I was not. They abused especially the nesting possibility in SCSS. And this is how the specificity graph looks like. I would like to call it the specificity wall. CSS was not invented to draw skylines in those graphs, but it happened. And rewriting was no option because this was, according to the backend developers, already the rewritten frontend. This was the UI in 2012 behind this specificity graph. This was one facelift we did in 2013, while in parallel tried to set up a dedicated frontend team because I was still the only frontend dev at Trivago. This was one of the most successful UI facelifts we ever did. It gained us a conversion plus of 5%. And this was the first UI which was kind of usable on a mobile phone, especially related to limited resources. We introduced a desktop-first adaptive design. Yay. And with all those facelifts and a bit of common sense while writing CSS, we were able to improve our code metrics, but sadly not maintainability and scalability. We had some issues. My favorite one is this. We tried to build Frankenstein with icons. This is nine different image byte sheets combined. Nobody had an overview of them anymore. They were used, I think, in 2,500 occurrences in the code base. I think more than half of them were even handcrafted in Photoshop, while the other half was built with a tool called Glue. We had a lot of CSS because we constantly reinvented the wheel. There is now one animation which will come in. That's our CSS checks how many selectors you use, and you can basically see that it exploded. What happened then? The browser refused your styles, so basically this was even on the production system, YOLO. Only part of the sites are rendered, but it's only CSS, I think, so it's important to stay calm. I just mentioned this as a new record, and our QA person answered with a completely valid question. Christoph, do we need that? No, of course not. And desktop first approach, and I'm on a CSS conference, so I don't have to tell you why that is bad. Inconsistency and a missing style guide. We had a bit of coding guidelines, I think only two. Use an underscore in your class name and don't nest more than three levels. Very basic. But what happens if you don't have a style guide? Then you can't complain about the 50 shades of gray. This is what happens if everybody has a different opinion on how a gray tone should look like, or if developers pick the colors with a color picker from a JPEG file attached to a Java task. But the same happened also to green. We use green to make money, but more green doesn't necessarily mean more money. We were slightly better with orange. Yeah, it's the same. I could do this with all colors and blue. And we had an overly complex CSS DOM structure. So the templates especially also didn't look better. Which of course also led to a lot of confusion and scary comments in the code. That's an example of excerpt of one of our CSS files. I think a completely valid question, why is set index so high? The next one, I like this one, no mix in because it will blow up RTL, which is right to left, our right to left platforms. A lot of other questions, so basically this all is a killer argument to don't touch this file at all because it can blow up platforms apparently. Defining the project and coming back to Project Iron Man and the scope. As already said, we developed a new CSS core, which used, I would say, a lot of best practices and stuff which you should do. Basically, we replaced the reset CSS with normalize. The default layout was then border box. Before that, we had content box, especially related to the fact that we supported IE7 until a year ago. We had those mobile first queries inside the new CSS core, while the old one was written with desktop first. We had the media queries inline. Before that, we had them external. So basically, we had separate files for the mobile definitions and wrapped them in one big media query. We did this to save file size. And we had this new SVG icons. We used a lot of this lovely methodologies like inverse triangle CSS, block element modifier, object-oriented CSS, and we also added some post-processing. So basically, you can see MQ Packer again bubbles this media queries then again to reduce our asset sizes. Coming back to the project name, three things were identified which we had to do on the old core to get it working with the new framework base. The first one was the normalize switch, including a border box. As we dropped IE7 support last year, we could do so. And finally, doing this cool stuff called mobile first and moving the media queries back to be inline. And replace the sprite chaos which we produced with our new SVG icons, which we built with a super cool tool from the Filament group called Grunt Icon. And we even adapted and built a customized loader for it. But there was one thing which was very important for the business side. We had to keep the existing layout and design. Every smaller change, e.g. to dimensions of a button, can already have impact on conversion, as we know, as a highly data-driven company. So this meant basically that we did not integrate any new components, that the super awesome ECSS, so basically here you have the global design system variables, here you have your mixins and tools, then you go more generic objects, and then here you would have your components. But as I already said, we just adapted the components and did not rewrite them. So what we did actually. That's our old folder structure. Don't ask me why we started this having an underscore in front of the folder name. In includes were basically everything. It could also be named everything instead of includes. Mixins, I think pretty obvious what this is. And as already said, we had this mobile folder which then duplicated the files. So in the includes folder, we had something like layout, elements, modules, which were basically, there was no real convention where to put something. So it's layout CSS could also have a component inside. But this was already a high specific, really a component. And, as already said, we had exactly the same files copied here with the mobile definitions. which of course led to a lot of maintainability issues. We put in the new base, but left out all those components and terms. And we made sure we even have some components which are loaded on demand, that at least every CSS file or every build target we use at least uses those both layers. Those both layers don't create any output, but they have all those functionality like the variables, like the XMXins and stuff like that. What did we do to the old CSS base? As already said, we could not completely get rid of it. We had to iterative adapt it. So we moved first the old declarations, so the old variables, into deprecation. The mixins, we moved them to deprecations, and then we started inside our old folder, first deleting everything which was very generic, and for example, page wrappers and stuff like that, which was needed for page layout. And we adapted and rewrite then those files. So basically applied border box, let them work with normalized CSS, and rewrite the media queries and moved them back inline so we could get rid of this complete folder. By doing this, we had to roughly adapt or rewrite or delete more than 50,000 lines of code. We had to remove all those icons from the image sprites. And of course, if you rewrite more than 50,000 lines of code, it's highly recommended that you retest your whole application again. The challenge about this project was that the time frame is limited because we didn't do it in parallel, and we have to move very fast at Trivago to keep up with our competitors. So, coming to the business side, this was basically one of the most challenging steps in this project. How to tell the management that you need 4 weeks of feature freeze, and the user interface will exactly look the same after that. So basically, you can't just go to your management and say, hey, stop, 4 weeks, I need to refactor all the codes, and they come with a valid question, why didn't you write the code in the first place and how you should do it? Yeah. So you have to, was basically one of the most learnings of this project. You have to prove the benefits. We have to at least document the downside of the current state. And with all those metrics I showed before, stuff like a specificity graph might not really understandable for non-technical people, but stuff like how many buttons you use, how many colors or icons you have, will also convince non-technical people that this needs to be cleaned up and avoided in the future. Of course, we as developers would like to have rewritten the whole front end, but this would have taken a much longer time frame, and we, of course, also have to see the business side. On the core product, the Trivago Hotel Search, are working more than 200 people, designers, product owners, developers, and it's just impossible to stop product development for a longer period of time. Some numbers and facts about the team and the process. This was our very lean and simple Kanban board. We put various tasks on it related to the scope of the project, e.g. adapting one of the old components to work with the new architecture. We have a very, you can't see it, but IE8 is three times in there. Yeah, we had to fight a bit with IE8. So how many people worked on this project and supported us? We did this. This was the project team, two QA engineers, three designers, and nine amazing, incredible driven front-end developers. But to all this preparation we did, of course, also Hoopala. The product owners were on our side, release engineer was happy, especially the performance lead was really looking forward how the performance will improve. Also the backend devs, if you come to them with basically stuff like Harry Roberts always does those cool methodologies, they will say, yeah, finally software engineering also comes into front end, and they were really cheering us up. The management was on our side, and we have some cute unicorns at Trivago who are always on our side. All in all, about the process, we had three meetings, the stand-ups in the morning, which were very important for us. And of course, the Slack channel. We had no estimation meeting, no sprint planning, no retrospective. We love to code instead of talking about code. Coming to some technical numbers about this refactoring project. We had a YOLO commit rate of 16 commits per hour, which resulted in 900 commits in 3 weeks. We had to add nearly 12,000 lines of code, which are basically or mostly coming from the new SCSS framework. But we deleted a lot of things. We moved more than 36,000 lines of code, CSS, HTML, JavaScript. We also were able, because especially of this high deletion rate, to reduce the overall CSS base nearly by 25%. We reduced the numbers of selectors by 21%, reduced the rules by 16%, and the declarations reduced by 17%. I have three showcases where I would like to show you how it looked before and after. Those have all some very minor animations in. Coming to this one, or maybe I'll show you before, I highlighted this container just here, that's our old result. And then you can see, first the desktop styles were loaded and then they were overwritten with the mobile styles. You basically can also see that we defined a border white here, which was never set on the desktop, but related to that it was in different files stored, was very unmaintainable for us. How did it look after? Very clean, we just had only one. Showcase number two is about the SVG icons and how they improved our CSS. I just highlighted again those four stars here, and they had, I think, two sites of style inspector just for displaying those icons. And after, it was just this needed for the icons. HTTP requests. As said, we removed all those image bytes and were also able to remove HTTP requests. Before that, in general, we loaded five sprites. You can also see we have a CTA sprite 92 and then 69. Yeah. As already said, there was a lot of chaos. And after that, it looked like this. So basically, you can see we didn't have any requests anymore. I think there's even, yeah. And we sorted the colors and introduced a new color palette. That's our new color palette with all shades of the main colors. And the developers don't need a color picker anymore to get their colors. I did this, I think, 4 weeks ago. This is also proven. We had before 60 colors, and you can now see that it's much cleaner now. And finally, we have control over the icons. We have an SVG icon set, so this is also stored in GitHub, in a Git repository, and makes it much more easy for us to maintain, add icons or remove icons, and also to find out where they're actually used. So this was the graph before the refactoring. You can see you have some very bad spikes in the beginning of the style sheet. Normally it should something like uptrending. And after Iron Man, this was exactly what we wanted to achieve. So basically you can see we moved in the new base, which has a kind of uptrending curve. We also were able, because we had to rewrite a bit here, to optimize it here, but this will now be tackled. As we are a data-driven company, we have to test everything. So we put this in an A-B test to see how this improved our metrics. I cannot tell you exactly what all those metrics are about, but you can might imagine that conversion is one which is important, also session rate or stuff like that. Very interesting to see this last column, I hope you can see it. That was the performance gain on Android Mobile. And this was so good, so that we basically could directly, I think after 2 days of testing, we released it. I went a bit crazy with my unicorn and my longboard in the office, which I like to do some from time to time. But one of our goals, which I mentioned in the beginning, were faster product iterations due to a more sustainable base. So here we go. We started now to rebuild our components. This is our most critical UI component. That is the search result item. The old one took us 9 months to develop and to qualify. This has a lot of functions and it works in 52 platforms of the world and right to left and whatever. And this is the new one, which we, I think, accepted 3 weeks ago. That's our new item element, which only took us 3 months to build instead of 9 months. So basically, this was also then at the end showing all those benefits we had from this refactoring. A small video and then already at the end, I would like to thank my company for helping me presenting those stuff and also sending me to this conference. And I hope you like my talk. I'm done.